Warning, adventure activities can be extremely dangerous. Please use extreme caution when out in the elements, and if you should, go ask your mom. Now, go ahead and in.
There's trash trucks. Look at the trash truck.
I was hoping to do a little camping and loitering.
Well, you're SOL, my brother.
Oh, man.
Because no camping and no loitering.
So really, where are we today?
My God, I'm not even sure. We are at a location that this whole series is going to start on, and we're going to go from the end and work backwards.
All right.
Does that make sense?
That does make sense.
Now, let's go see a guy that we know. That
gonna go visit an old friend.
This is his final resting place of the probably the biggest legend ever, right? I mean, it seriously is.
As far as this story is concerned,
you know, we're going to research and we're going to attempt to find and solve the biggest riddle in Southwest history and maybe world history, really.
What is that?
The Lost Dutchman.
Oh, we're on a Lost Dutchman day.
Okay. Now, if you happen to go down here and you go across, you probably don't want to be down there. Because
yeah, that's not a good place to go right now.
Probably the Lost Dutchman would be probably safer in the Superstitions than it would be down here. Another jet coming across. So where are we standing? We're standing on the corner of 15th Avenue and Harrison. So why in the hell would we be here, James?
We're here to visit the grave of Jacob Waltz.
And you'll see right here it says Pioneer Cemetery. Now, another thing is, if you want to follow us on this journey, it's not the best place to be. And it's hard to get in because I've been in here before. But, you know, because they have so much trouble down here, they lock the doors because they don't let you even in here. But right there on the corner, with that little marker, is the grave of the Lost Dutchman. So one thing we want to talk about, James, is this. So one thing we know in the Lost Dutchman is, whether we believe or you don't believe, right, is that he did exist.
He absolutely existed. He was a real person. We know where he lived and we know where he's buried.
So we do know that he was real, and we do know that he did exist, and we do know that he is buried
right
there. So the story begins where it ended. So from this point on, we're going to go and we're going to try to solve the mystery and the history of the Lost Dutchman. Now, we're going to go from here, we're going to go to his residence, to prove again that this guy really did exist. There was a Lost Dutchman. He really was a miner, right?
Right.
And we're going to also take a look at some of the other mysteries about this while we start to debate and figure out where we're going to start this journey, which is going to be epic. I hope you come along and I hope you subscribe, because if you like this information and you like doing this with us, don't miss any of it. Okay, James, no dumping. No parking, no breathing.
Don't do anything here.
You can't do anything here, but what you can do is this. You can come across this street right here, and you can look at the corner of 14th and Pima, and what you've got generally is this was the Lost Dutchman's farm. Basically from here, east, and north. So he had this acreage right in here. Now there's one thing that's incredible about this location to me personally, is that you can see South Mountain, which is a big deal because that's where we're headed next. But the other big deal is this. If you look down there, you can see,
on a clear day,
the Superstition Mountains right down there. Isn't that funny that you could
see down there, that's Flatiron in the haze.
Exactly. So you could see from his farm the Superstition Mountains. Is that just...
And in the late 1800s, it would have been nothing obstructing, right?
Exactly.
So you're imagining a guy who could walk out every day and look out.
Isn't that funny?
Flatiron.
See, I think that's a clue, James. I believe that that's a clue that he could see this because it's a lot of miles down there. We're going to maybe try to find that out also. So come along with us. Now we're going to go to the third clue of the Lost Dutchman, which kind of throws a little bit of a wrench into what we got going on. But let's go to South Mountain Park.
Going that way.
Going to find a mine. And that's what we're here to seek today, is the Max Delta Mine. So James, here we are at South Mountain Park, one of the biggest parks in the United States. And the west side of this park was completely gold mining. So we're gonna go up there and see if we can find one of the biggest puzzles that I have about this gold mine within earshot of the Lost Dutchman homestead. So let's go on up, let's go see what we can find. So James, the journey takes us to South Mountain Park. And, you know, a lot of people are going to say, well, what does South Mountain Park have to do with the Lost Dutchman lore? And now this is something I need to work through. If you look down that hill, you're going to see downtown Phoenix about 12 miles from here.
Where we were just at, yep.
So there is a mine up here that we're going to go see. And it's the Maximilian Mine. And it's the second largest gold producing mine next to the Vulture Mine in Maricopa County. So I have always been confused at why would he go to the Superstitions if he had gold this close? Does that make sense?
Yeah. That does make sense. That seems like a bit of a quandary.
So that is where I'm kind of like, I have to work through this because...
Right there.
There's the mine.
The Maxim Delta,
yes.
It's called, right?
Yes.
If you look it up today.
And some people call it the Maximilian Mine. So Max Delta is right there. And it was a huge mine. It's not a small area.
No, that's got some heavy tailings.
So it's like, if a guy was that close, why would he not have come to the South Mountain to mine gold? And so that's something that we need to work through to try to figure out what was the clues and what was the reason. And so we need to go to this mine, see what kind of gold mine it was. And hopefully what that'll do is it'll give us a little more information to get this clues and to get the Lost Dutchman lore figured out, because it doesn't make any common sense to me even, yeah, as a believer.
Yeah. Well, this is like early 1900s, right?
Yes.
This is like 1910s.
Yes. But he would have, you know, if you're a miner, and he was a miner, we have proof that he was a miner at the Vulture Mine, yeah, which is the number one producer of gold in the area. Why wouldn't he have mined here?
Interesting.
Because miners know mining, right? I mean, they know. I mean, I can look at a mine and, you know, I'm not JeffWilliams.com, and that's who I'll call if we find gold. But
it is odd because it would be a much closer trip out here if you can tell geology-wise there is gold in the mountains to go all the way out there.
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely.
Well, I see that adds to my skepticism as to, like, how this all adds up. But we'll see.
But there, you know...
You're going to convince me.
It depends. I have to see what kind of a gold this is, and then that will also lead me to believe that, you know, what is the reasoning. So, you know, I'm not a skeptic, but I have to look at all the facts, right? And make a sensible determination of what's right and what's wrong. So let's go to this mine and let's see what kind of mine it is. So James, here we are, South Mountain Mine. And this was a major operation. This was not, if you look up here, and they're trying to keep you out, which I definitely understand, this shouldn't still be open, but it is. So the major operation, it was all of South Mountain. Now here's the clue. If you look at this over here, what you've seen is they had a leaching process, right? So they wouldn't picking up placer gold, right? Now the technology wouldn't have been readily available for the Dutchman at that time. He wouldn't have been able to come up with this. This was a major multi, I won't say million, but there's a lot of money spent here.
Yeah. So in the late 1800s, one individual prospector would not be running an operation like this, you're saying?
You couldn't have got this done. Yeah. You know, this was,
This is all the residue of chemical treatment, leaching, sluicing.
Actually, yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
I get what you're saying.
So the good news is this. It wouldn't have been available to him. So now I get that, right? So now I can go on and place this off the list because...
Not a viable source of gold.
Exactly.
I get, okay.
Perfect. See, that was the only thing that always confused me was if he had gold close, why would he go 60 miles?
But when you're here, you realize this was just not...
Yeah, it wasn't feasible.
It wasn't in the cards for one prospector.
So, you know, even though we spent a lot of time just getting up here, you know...
Kind of worth it to check it off.
You can check it off now, because I would have had a real problem if you would have told me that the gold was viable and he didn't come up here, because there's his house right there.
Exactly.
So if you look out there,
That's where we just came from earlier today.
So you want to run 13 miles or 65 or 70 with a mule, right?
Absolutely.
So I'm excited. That just shows me that, okay.
Well, we check one more of the...
Well, and as we're going down this journey, right, we have to check all this stuff off.
Exactly.
Because, you know, if we're really going to do, you know, the history and the mystery of the Lost Dutchman. So what do you think about this, James?
Well, this definitely tells me that Jacob Waltz would not have been coming up here to do any prospecting. So it does open up, again, some reasoning why the Superstition Mountains then come back into play.
Okay.
But beyond that, I have no idea, man, because, I mean, we still have the whole vulture mine thing that will open up later as we go up there and investigate more. Because we do have the records of him being an employee of the Vulture Mine, correct?
Right. So if we kind of put this in a little bit of a scenario, right? So what we've got is we've got Jacob Waltz. We've got history of where he died. We've got his farm. We've got records at the Vulture Mine that he worked there and he was a miner. And now I can cross up the fact that why wouldn't he go 13 miles from his house versus 60, right?
Yes.
Because this was not capable. He was not capable of this level, and they weren't capable of this level at that time in the early 1900s, right?
Right.
So now we checked this one off, but we also checked off the fact that we know he's not some mystery guy. He's real.
Yes.
He lived. And now we can take that, and then we can go forward with the mystery, right?
Okay.
So, what's your thoughts? So,
yes, Jacob Waltz is real. Yes, we know he had gold. They have evidence of the type of gold he found in the matchbox that they had made. And that's it so far. That's where I'm at. He was a real guy.
But doesn't that kind of swing you a little bit? You know, I'm not saying you got to commit fully, James, but I'm saying... Doesn't that, we got a guy, he's real. We got a guy, he existed. We got a guy that was a miner. We got a guy that had gold, right?
Absolutely.
You know, so you got to sway a little bit, right?
All that tells me is that he had gold. It does not tell me there's $200 million worth of gold hidden out there yet.
But James, we know there is.
You really want there to be. I want there to be. I think it would be awesome, but...
You know, James, probably the sign that we ought to take in stride is the one that says, do not enter.